Morning.
Welcome. There's been a rumor going around the church for a long time now. It seems that every Sunday it's my turn to be liturgist. They think the attendance falls off. And I'm so glad to see each of you dispel that rumor so it can't happen anymore. We're happy to have the choir from Faith here this morning and look forward to their music. And also, Sarah's here, and we have Paul over on the soundboard. And we'd like to introduce you to Byron Ransom. He had been a member of Crystal Park until he was in the sixth, or until he got to the sixth grade. And whether he was in New York or came back to Faith Church, he has always been active and served in many areas of the church. And we look forward to his message today. On the announcement side, we wanted to mention that today is Emma Gottschalk's birthday, and we wish him the very best, along with Debbie Green and Juan Summers. We're still collecting sugar and detergent soap and laundry soap for Faith Kitchen. Are there any other announcements? If not, we'll have the prelude and lighting of the candles. Stand if you're able for a call to worship, pray responsibly. The Lord is our light and our refuge.
He is our faithful companion.
He will guide us in his ways.
The Lord is our rock and salvation.
Glory to God. Our hymn of intention, Be Thou Vision, on the screen or in page 451 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
scripture we're going to read this morning from the hymnal on page 769, or it will be on the screen, and we will read it responsibly. I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth.
My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the wicked hear and be glad.
O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together.
I sought the Lord, who answered me, and delivered me from all my fears.
Look to God and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed.
The Lord cried out, and the Lord heard, and saved them out of all their troubles.
The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear God and delivers them.
O gaze and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in God.
If our ushers will come forward, we'll present our tithes and offerings. Thank you.
accept these gifts we bring to you today, and may they multiply your work here and throughout the world. We come now to a time of sharing our celebrations and concerns, and so Paul, I think that you probably have a better idea what's going on there today.
Several concerns that have already been lifted for us today, even before worship or during Sunday school. We continue to keep Gary Conley in our prayer. Gary did get some what we consider a little bit good news this week as he talked with his doctor. They have taken him off of the medication, that expensive $2,500 medication that he was on for each dosage. They felt that was making him worse. And after taking him, weaning him off of that medication, the doctor said this week, we will wait till June to decide about any further testing. So that's, he's still on oxygen 24/7, like, but it's good news. So continue to keep him in prayers, but also it's a joy that he got some good news that makes him feel a little bit better. So we continue to keep him in our prayers. We want to pray. Bud's cousin died this week, Sharon Graham. Somebody we saw the article probably in the paper. She was her and her husband owned Arrowhead Orchards, and she passed away this week. Her funeral was, I think, just yesterday. And so we lift up the Graham family on Sharon's death. Her sister-in-law, you might remember that about 3 weeks ago, her brother-in-law passed away and the sister was in the hospital, or the wife of the brother-in-law was in the hospital. She passed away, and so her memorial service is this week. So we lift up Sarah Thompson, Gary's sister-in-law. We want to continue to remember Mary Binkley and Mary Rawlings in our prayers. And their health concerns and life concerns. We continue to lift up Bud. We are glad that Bud is back with us today. So that's one of our joys, that he's here in worship. He has not been able to be here since June, so we're glad he is back. But he still has a ways to go, and so we continue to pray for his strength. We're also glad to have Kathy Ramsey back with us today. So Kathy, welcome. We're glad you are back in worship with us today. And Kathy had just had some cataract surgery. So we were glad that she's doing well and back with us in worship today. Other prayer joys or concerns? Oh, I should have done one other one. And that is Reverend Ed Ashmall. People I know from Faith United will know him very well. People from Crystal Park. Reverend Ed was here on the day that we had our initial celebration of the Quabarat greetings from, because Ed works at the conference office, and is hospitalized with COVID. And so we want to lift him up in prayer. And so please keep Reverend Ashfall in your prayers. Other joys or concerns you would like to share this day? Again, the joy that we have the choir here today. It's wonderful. Thank you. Great music. Thank you very much, and thank you for it.
You know, that's just been an attitude of prayer. We'll first do silent prayer, and our pastoral prayer, and the Lord's Prayer. So, as we, Lord, hear the prayers that are on our hearts. Lord, we come today with hearts of mixed feelings, saddened by the suffering from the effects of the COVID. We pray that you bring relief and comfort. We are thankful for the progress being made to find a cure for it. We pray for the end of the violence that is sweeping across the nation and the world. We give thanks for those who protect and care for those in need. We ask your blessing and healing to those in need that have been brought to us this morning in our prayer concerns. And we celebrate the great things shared here today. We ask that you give us strength, courage, and insight to face the unseen challenges that will be put before us this week. Help us to turn them into opportunities to bring your love to those in need of comfort. Thank you for being here with us today. We ask that you be with us this week and help us to spread your message to others. Now let us pray the Lord, spread the prayer that Jesus taught to his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The scriptures this morning, they're going to come from three different places in the New Testament. The first is from Luke 11, 9-10. All my stuff over here one time. And so the first is from Luke 11, verses 9 and 10. It says, so do you ask, and it will be given. You search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be open for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds. For everyone who knocks, the door will be open. The second comes from the Gospel of Mark. It's chapter 14, verses 32 through 35. They went to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake. And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, that the hour might pass from him. And then the last is from them. It's from 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, in the verses 12 and 13. For just as the body is one, there is, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, which so it is with Christ. For in one spirit, we are all baptized into one body. Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we are all made to drink in one spirit. I'll refer to all of these in a little while as I go through my message here today. So we do have another hymn that for centering, and it's called, you find it on page 214 of your hymnal, and it's called In the Garden. Thank you. were part of this, the program he was doing. They showed him remarkable in turning things around and getting better. A lot of them did away with their cancer. Those that didn't, they showed those signs of improving, or they got worse. And so I always look at that lesson as being one that really tells us we need to laugh. And that picture says to Jesus wants us to laugh. So that I want to, before I get too far along, I want to also mention that we talked about the three pictures. I'm going to bring you to show you a fourth one, if I get my fingers working right here. During last week in the paper, I noticed an ad for a Hamilton figurine. There's this figurine of this angel. I hope you can see it well enough. But on it says, God does not give you what you can handle. God helps you handle what you are given. And wow, wait a minute, that takes a whole different picture to that meaning. It's always, God only gives you what you can handle. Well, it never says he's going to in there help you, even though I guess we just assumed it. But I thought that it made me look back and reflect on what I had was going to say today a little differently, because I thought, if that's the way it is, I've been getting a lot of help. Maybe I didn't give enough proper thanks and recognition to God or to the people that were responsible for helping. So if you think about it, that saying, think of it in those terms from now on, that he's there helping us. He's not just putting us there by ourselves where we have nothing to relate to or go back to or count on. He tells us he'll be there. He won't abandon us, that he'll be with us forever. And so let me just share with you again, the day's sermon message was blessed, loved, and redeemed. Now, those of you that know me, those are my initials. And some time ago, I was on one of the mission trips with the kids, and we were asked to do a prayer journal the week we were there. And we were asked to take our initials and put them together. It took me probably half a week before I finally got struck by the bolt of lightning, and it said, you know, it means blessed, loved, and redeemed. As I stopped and reflected on that then and since then, the Lord certainly has blessed my life in many different ways. Sometimes I didn't understand how I was doing it. Like when I talked later about training a mission trip over to others to take over and run it, I didn't know why. I didn't think I was ready. 2 years later, I had a heart attack. I'd have been at the middle of a trip if that had happened. The other part of that is, and was I spared at that time? Well, just about 2 or 3 years after that, I had plans of my wife having dementia. And this last year, the Lord brought her home to take her away from the suffering that she was going through from that. So he speaks to us in different ways. We don't always hear it, but the message is there. And then somebody told me how blessed I have been, how loved I have been, and then my soul has been redeemed. So as we go through, I'll share some other stories with you and things about how I acquired a stronger and life-changing faith in Jesus Christ. But before we do that, I want you to take your church bulletin and read together with me the mission statement for Crystal Park United Methodist Church. So if you join me, the mission of Crystal Park United Methodist Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the community and beyond. Well, that when I read that, it inspired me to go beyond that. How can I make that a more meaningful, trackable thing for myself or for even others that might come in contact? If you'll open your bulletin to the front, you will see on there an acrostic that I asked Paul to put on here, because after I read that and was inspired, this is something that came to my mind. And so if you see there, Christ, your soul towards achieving lasting participation, acquiring reliable knowledge, using masterful challenges, helping us reach Christian humbleness. You think about that mission statement, that's what it's saying. It's asking us to do those things. How are we going to make disciples for God and Jesus if we don't rally our souls towards achieving lasting participation or acquiring knowledge that's useful and helping us to meet the challenges he puts before us? Not always easy to to see those and do them. But if we keep that in mind, well, I'd like you to take one step further during this week. I want you to take and make your own Christ-centered mission statement for yourself. And then challenge yourself to daily read it and live by that. I think you'll see even a greater love and appreciation for what the Lord's done and what He will bring to us. So as we look at that, I'll proceed further with my talk for the day. It says, my acquiring a strong and life-changing faith in Jesus Christ. Well, it was about 55 years ago. I moved back to North Canton from New York City. I'd been living there for 10 years, and it was to help my mother care for a couple of nephews that had been awarded to her by the courts. And as I here, so I was working on Sundays a lot of times and wasn't able to go to church. Well, one Sunday, I happened to have a Sunday off, and I said to Josephine, my wife, I said, come on, let's go. We're going to church today. We haven't been there for a long time, and that's certainly been a part of our life, and we don't want it to stop now. Well, it almost ended my church going, because as I got there and sat in a Sunday school class with a gentleman that was a charter member of the church and lived across the street from my mother, we were referring to a question that was asked about in reference to the Bible first that day. And he says, oh, I can't believe that about you. I know you from when you were smaller. And I really hit me hard. And I went to the church service, went home, told my wife, we're not going back anymore, there or any place else. She said, why? I said, if that's the kind of people that are making up the church today, I want no part of it. I said, that's not Christ speaking. That's the devil speaking. And I said, I can't believe that man ever said that. Well, went home that night, and I went to sleep, and then nothing happened a couple of days later. Well, all of a sudden I get, boyish. And when I'm down to sleep, that's, and I hear this thing. I'm going, wait a minute, who's in the house? What's going on? I'm going to tell you, if you've ever been woke up from a dead sleep, somebody calling your name, you're awake and you're paying attention, because nothing's going to make you any more awake than that. Well, I said to myself, what's going on here? And so he, at that point, said, do you remember in New York City when you were near death and you had gone towards the light and found yourself in an area that was green, the greenest you had ever seen, and the foliage was more beautiful than any you had ever seen, and you were starting to get in a boat to go to the other side? When all of a sudden, a voice cried out, you can't come in because we're still not done with you. Go back. Well, at that time, I didn't know the whole story or what was going on, but I went back and I told Josephine about it the next morning. So we did go to church the next evening. Well, it just happened to be that Sunday, a woman got up and says, anybody that's interested in reading scriptures and commenting on them, please see me after the church service because we need to have some volunteers. Well, I thought about it during the church service. Didn't hear the sermon that day because I was too busy thinking about what was I being called to do. And so I found myself seeking her out after church and saying, if you have a scripture Sunday that's available. And so I found myself at that time, sort of like when I was in New York at the old Madison Square Garden, my feet moved towards me. I didn't know why they were doing it. It wasn't me doing it. It was somebody behind me moving me. Again, God moving me towards being more of a servant and getting more out of the life. Well, at the old Madison Square Garden, when I was in New York, Billy Graham had a crusade going on there. And my minister in my church was very involved in it. So he incorporated all of us that he could to be ushers. Unfortunately, my job was always at the top part of the old Madison Square Garden. If any of you had ever been there years ago at the old Madison Square Garden, that was a big place and very high up. Well, every night when Dr. Graham would end his sermon, he would have a calling asking people to come down to the altar and to be accept Christ as their in their altar. And I used to say, oh, come on, that's a bunch of hooey, that's hogwash. Nobody does those things. And so, I found myself that last night, the crusade, all of a sudden starting to move my feet towards the stairway. Now, that's a long way down, so I had to really hustle. And so I can't hustle now because his knees that were good then aren't so good now. But and I got down there, found myself standing in front of Billy Graham's Clifton, and I found myself accepting God because I had never accepted him before. I got a phone call that night. Actually, we talked about Jesus knocking. Jesus is knocking. And it's about the fifth time you've already heard that and the things I've shared with you. And he said, the phone call, she said, would you mind reading scripture for this vacation Bible school sermon? Yeah, that's fine. I'll do it. Then as I picked up the scripture during the week, I found out there were going to be all the vacation Bible school kids there. They were going to be participating in the service. Their parents would be there. And it was five verses were the ones from Corinthians that I read to you earlier. And I got, oh my Lord, how am I going to get this message across so that they will understand, so that the kids will walk out of here feeling inspired and wanting to do something. So Stan figured it out, driving to church, and I'm turning it into the parking lot of church. And I said to my wife, because it all of a sudden hit me, said, go home, don't ask any questions now, I don't have time to explain. Pick up the old wind alarm clock and bring it back. She says, okay, I don't understand. I said, you'll understand when I'm done. So I was there, she brought it in, and when I got and read the scripture, I picked up this clock. I said, this clock scripture. I said, then same thing at this church. Used to be we see the stained glass windows, we see the preachers, we see the things that are going on. But we don't see all the behind the scene things. I said, it's like this clock. It tells us the time here. But when you take it back off and show, there's the inner parts. If they weren't working, we wouldn't know what time it was. And so as I did that, I was hit with, because I left church and we're walking down the hallway outside Robinson Hall, this little white-haired lady running down the hallway going, Byron, Byron, I want to talk to you. And I go, oh my God, what did I do something to offend somebody? And she says, Irwin Jennings and he was the senior minister at the church at the time, have been trying to put this program together where we take the kids, from kindergarten to fourth, would have their own church service during the first and third Sundays of the week, of the month. And so I said, well, let me think about it and pray about it, because I'm not sure that I'm the one qualified to do that. Well, it didn't take long before was come knocking again. He must have had sore knuckles by the time he got done. I mean, he probably still got sore when he was trying to get me to do other things. And so, and I agreed to do it. And after a lot of deliberation and the talking, the nicest thing about that program to me was that these young kids, kindergarten through the fourth grade, were able to read the scriptures, do the call to worship, and do those things. And they felt a part of the church. They felt more that they were involved in what was going on. To see them just being when I get to read the scripture today. I get to do the call to worship. Whatever it was they were doing, they were so tickled to death. Now, it sort of reminded me when I was a young here came to church, Fred Rice, I thought was the Sunday school superintendent, I'm not sure, but anyway, he was a very active member. And Fred and his wife, Fred always made a point to know the kids' names, to make them feel comfortable, even not only here, but at the bank, Canton National Bank, which was on the square, Canton at the time. And when he came in, if he came out and talked to me, if he was ushering that day, he didn't ring the bell. You could ring the bell to bring people to church. Oh, well, I felt like a big shot. And I'm sure the others did too. But I noticed that when we come in the door, there's a window dedicated to the Rice, by the Rices, and I think that is Fred's mother and dad. I'm not sure, because that's sure my memory's sharp on that, but I think there's another one of these windows that's dedicated to his wife's mother and father as well. But Fred was as good as to have him, because even with this trying to make kids feel good, the church, the faith, when I was doing the custodial work on Sundays or during the week at the preschool, I'd sometimes have to put up the backboards, and there'd be the kids, can we do that, can we do that? Yeah, come on, let's go do it. And once in a while, and my parents, nowadays would hang me, take me for a ride on the Zamboni, and things and so forth. And I just thought that was the greatest thing in the world because, yeah. But the other thing that was important, I learned their names. And that I shouldn't value the importance of that. When I taught the Dale Carnegie programs for 20-some years, then one of the principles out there, remember that to a person, their name is the sweetest, most important sound in any language. Some people say, oh, I can't remember this. Yeah, you can remember. You have to want to do it. It's anything in life. You can't say, I can't do it. But you can also say, I want to do it and find a way to get there. Might not be easy. God never promised us anything easy. He told us, you know, our way would be, you know, difficult, but we would get there. And so those kids I met, and I have to be honest, I'm sure that some of the Sunday school teachers, or the preschool teachers, wished I wouldn't walk down the hall as if the door was open and go, Mr. Butch, and we'd have to stop and talk to them. And of course, that disrupted what they were trying to do. Let me just share with you a couple of other things. And because you'll be here till next week. After 25 years of junior church and 25 years taking high school kids on mission trips, I've got a story for more than one story for every year. But I remember one of them was to Muscatine, Iowa. We went out there a year after the Mississippi had flooded and destroyed a lot of things. Ben McGee was the district superintendent at that time, did a charge conference at our church, and he brought up the fact that we were needing volunteers and people to go. I hadn't decided where we were going to go that year, but that became a mission to go there. So I got it together. And while we were there, we were working on one woman's house that was right on the river. And her house had been had a lot of damage. That house had been damaged 20 years prior to that. And her father took and put three more cinder blocks on the foundation so it would raise it up, and hopefully the next time it would not flood again. Well, guess what? It did. Not much, but it enough to do some damage. And so we were working there. We were doing the outside work, and that's all we were supposed to do because the other stuff inside was going to be done by somebody else. And so we signed another job where they needed the drywall ripped out so that they could decontaminate how it was rebuilt and lived in. Well, while we were there the next day, about 2 hours, here comes one of the people from the flood relief asking us to go back to the house. I'm going, what are you talking about? We just left there. I mean, I was fully disappointed that we had to, you know, leave what we were doing to go back. And I wasn't too happy about it, but did what was asked of me. Went back and was talking to that lady later that day. Come to find out that during the height of the flood, her husband said, I've had enough of this, I'm leaving, and I'm getting a divorce. And all she wanted wasn't so much us to be there, to do the work, the physical work around their house. It was to do the emotional work, to help her regain herself. I found out later that she said that the 4 days that we were there were the most meaningful days to her and helped her see things a little different, that people did care and went there. The other example I'll share with you is that we were in New Orleans 2 years after Katrina, and we were down there doing, and that's where I learned to manage from a hospital bed. The trip got started. We also, the other part of the trip, we took youth from, and the Rabbi Spitzer from Temple Israel, and that was a great experience because we got to experience some of their religious beliefs. They got to experience some of ours, even though we have to get together and towards a common goal and for God's purpose. Well, I started getting these pains the day before we left, but I thought, it's nothing, I'll get over it. Well, it got worse and worse, and I guess the easiest way to relate to how painful it was, I said, if a man has never been pregnant, I know what the feelings are, the pain of pregnancy. I said, I think I came the closest that a man could get to it. But anyway, we were there, and after a couple of days, I turned to Andy Gillette, and his wife was with us, and she's a nurse at the VA hospital. And so he took me over to the hospital. They said, we're going to have to keep him. He's got a twisted colon. We'll have to operate tomorrow. So two things that came out of that was I was being brought to the surgery the next day. I was so drugged up, I didn't really cognizant of what was all going on, but there was a figure next to my gurney, white robe, bright white robe, walking with me. And after I come to my senses and things, I realized that Jesus was walking with me, telling me that even though I was far from home, that he was there with me and that everything would be all right. And they were flying my wife down to make sure she was there in case anything needed to be done or happen. So the other part of that trip was it told me at that time, God speaks to us and demands for success. Well, I already been planning that for some time. And this young man was the only one that I took as a freshman in college. Because the rest of my life had always been a standing rule. You had to be 2 years away from the program. Well, I'm going to say that I won't embarrass him. He's here today. But he took over and did a remarkable job for 5 or 6 years that he ran. And so it taught me that no matter what we're doing in life, we need to be prepared and have things prepared so others can take over from us. The underlying message behind all this is that we have many blessings. We are loved by the Lord. And as you can see, he does redeem our souls when it needs to be done. We need to assemble, look at those strengths and talents that we have, put them together, and ask the Lord to use them. When we do that, it's untold what he'll do. I mean, as I said to someone coming in here today, I said, the thing that strikes out to me is that God does come to us in a different way. He does ask us to, and he puts us in there. Like it says on the angel, he helps us get through the things that we're given. And he certainly has that. I want to share you one thing I went over about with Laughing Jesus. I was glad when the choir was here, and I do thank you for being here today, because as they know, I can't sing. In fact, I love to sing. And the only place I'm allowed to sing is at home in the shower. Well, I am so bad that when I get in the shower and turn the water on, I start singing, the water turns off and won't turn back on until I start singing. So let me just leave you with that. You know that we all have lots of skills, lots of talents, and things that are there at our disposal to use if God will, if we'll just ask God to make use of it. So I just like to say thank you for allowing me to be here. Thank you for this opportunity to Paul and to Teresa and to the worship committee. It's been a pleasure to be here and share some things that I recall and have been an important part of making me the person that I am. Thank you for having me. We're ready for our last hymn. She should be out. How Great Thou Art. Should be 77. I've got that one memorized.
Amen.
down here this morning and say, Pam, good to see you, as well as the choir. So let us go forth in Jesus' name and be a living example of God's love. God, go with you in peace. Amen.